Oh, this.
Really? No.
Born in the 50s, you know? Most people don't know that.
Right.
So, anyway.
This evening.
I actually feel immediately much more rooted because that's where I'm from. I never felt rooted to South Carolina, both culturally, the institution was converting us all just effectively to independent contractors housed in the same place. If you actually looked at the way we were being treated, the building community, they weren't invested in South Carolina. They were just in Louisville.
are.
And I was
that'll be fun.
Really.
So, let's talk. I'll be up in Berkeley.
Yeah.
I mean, well, my favorite course is my global politics.
So what you're going to I would just say, the one thing you're running into is like
that community is mostly now,
28
to
29 physical science and engineering.
Diane
now
the
I'm hearing that now rare earth geopolitics and one and sort of
from so he left NRDC.
It's like trade and it's great.
He left NRDC and was a Brazilian
as the civil rights director of some
think
tank thing. I don't know what it is. He's the head of it no one has ever heard of.
With water filters, you're full. I'm going to punch it right in the head.
Shortly going to run for governor.
Right.
Good afternoon. Wow, it's good to have a nice, full, packed house of people carrying on conversation. So good afternoon. Welcome to the Wilson Center and to our discussion this afternoon on the conflict potential of climate change adaptation and mitigation, Backdraft Revisited. I'm Roger Mark D'Souza, the Director of Population, Environmental Security and Resilience here at the Wilson Center. I know many of you are familiar with the Wilson Center. We serve as a living memorial to President Wilson, and most recently was recognized by the University of Pennsylvania as the number one think tank globally for transdisciplinary research. So I think when we think about this afternoon's topic, it is a topic that we see crossing many disciplines. And we're very pleased to have this afternoon's discussion coming just after the White House's announcement of steps to address climate change and national security with the presidential memorandum that came out just last week and together with the new intelligence assessment that came out. Of course, we planned today's event taking that into account. So we're very pleased to have that as an opportunity to engage this afternoon. I hope you've had a chance. I know many of you are familiar with our report of a few years ago, our Backdraft report looking at unintended consequences of climate change programs. And we'll be looking at that again this afternoon. And I'm very pleased to welcome back a longtime colleague and friend who's the former director of the Environmental Change and Security Program here at the Wilson Center, Jeff DeBelko, who's currently a professor and director of environmental studies at the George V. Vinovich School of Leadership and Public Affairs at Ohio University in Athens, Ohio. And Jeff will be with us this afternoon moderating the discussion. So Jeff, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you very much, Roger Mark. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Welcome. Thank you so much for coming and joining what we really intend to have as a conversation. We're having, as the title suggested, an opportunity to revisit this notion of backdraft, one dimension among many under a climate and security or climate and fragility rubric or an umbrella, and as Roger Mark said, one that got a boost, shall we say, with the presidential memorandum this last week. And that's, of course, context that we want to engage with today. At the same time, I think part of what we hope will be a benefit from this conversation is that we will talk about some of the issues that might be flagged in the short versions and the press releases and the first order discussion of the topic, but also importantly, some of the things that haven't traditionally, if we can say traditionally for a topic that primarily is a 2007 to present one, if we're focusing on the climate security link, certainly as many of you in this room and have been in this room for a lot longer than that, looking at environment and security links, that's a longer discussion. But in that sense, our work 6, 7, 8 years ago that culminated in the Backdraft report was to try to find some of the areas in which there hadn't been as much attention. And it's still a broad umbrella if we were to say Backdraft is looking at the conflict and or the peace building, because we want the glass half full as well as half empty. But the conflict or peace building potential of how we respond to climate. So our policy, our practitioner on the ground and at 30,000 foot, our responses to climate change in a mitigation space and in an adaptation space. A lot of attention, and rightly so, on trying to understand what direct physical impacts and then immediate responses, like say a migration scenario would have in a security context, or particularly a lot of attention around organized violence. But part of what you'll see today by the work that folks here are doing is that there's a whole lot more to that, and there's a whole other category where conflict more broadly defined that may be inclusive of that very high and relatively rare still threshold of violence. If we expand that out, that there's a lot to talk about in terms of how we essentially need to go in with our eyes open for policy responses to climate change and make sure we do that, full stop, say that, right? So part of this is done in part because it's seen as necessary steps, but ones that need to be done with eyes open and done well, because the implications of responding poorly vis-a-vis the issues we'll talk about today in terms of conflict and peace building can have further negative consequences. And so in that sense, it's still a big umbrella if we're talking about transition in the energy sectors or mitigation schemes like reduced emissions from deforestation, forest degradation, or RED schemes. You'll hear the acronym RED used today. That there's still a lot there, and you'll hear about even in more than that. And so part of what we'll do is have some illustrative pathways out of that umbrella, or that's not the right metaphor, that's mixing metaphors, but some different strands under this umbrella term. We will put a particular emphasis on ground up and ground level up rather than top down. For those of you familiar with the climate security discussion, a lot of that has been state level actors and security doctrines and diplomatic agendas and a top down, and we're gonna try to emphasize some of the issues around bottom up. Some new and exotic stuff, as Ken put it, as he gave me the terrific four-part outline for how we're gonna structure today. We're gonna turn to him for the new and exotic stuff that the crisis that around climate change presents in terms of potential responses. And then again, we want to make sure in the discussion and be highlighted, I think, in a couple instances, how this connects, what it might tell us about how we, and some of you, tackle the charge, the 90-day and the 150-day charge that comes in the presidential memorandum and associated efforts. And so, as I said, kind of facilitating a conversation, we have a lot of people, as you can see, more than what would be a traditional panel. But instead of picking a few to have them give longer presentations talking at you, we thought we would have some call on them to talk about what this is meaning and some of the work that they've done that they'd like to see get done, or even some friendly critiques of what has been done, and get some of those issues out there, have some benefit from the diversity of these perspectives, and then allow us to take the conversation where it goes. In alphabetical order, I'll make it really quick. Josh Busby's here. Josh from UT Austin is an associate professor, LBJ School of Public Affairs. Ed Carr is coming down from Clark now. It used to be up from University of South Carolina. Down from Clark, a director of International Development Community Environment Department there, a geographer. Let's see, turn the page. Ken Konka is here now. We're happy after many years of talking about it. We finally have Ken as a fellow at the Wilson Center, but he's here in town at American University, where he's a professor of international relations. Jesse Ribot, again, welcoming back as a former Wilson fellow. Jesse is a professor of geography, anthropology, and natural resource environmental studies, director of social dimensions of environmental policy program, University of Illinois. Someone who spent a lot of time here in town at WRI and now out in Illinois. Kim Marion Suiza is a new professor at Northwestern. Before that, it was at Purdue. Before that, it was at Duke. She's terrific to have Kim come. Is this your first time at the Wilson Center speaking? Yeah, so one of our objectives of getting together for this session, as well as some of the earlier ones, are make some connections. So it's appropriate that you and Jesse are sitting next to each other, for example. So we're thrilled to have Kim come and join and share her insights. Stacy Vanderveer is an old hand here at the Wilson Center, familiar at this table to many of you. Easily, my easy introduction saying he was the chair of the political science at University of New Hampshire is no longer the case. He's now a professor at University of Massachusetts Boston in Global Governance Human Security Program. So welcome, Stacy, back to the center. And also another veteran, Janani Vivekananda, is from International Alert, came in from London. We appreciate that very much. And has been someone working on this climate and security space from a peace-building organization's perspective for many years. And so it's great to welcome Janani back. So with that introduction, let's get the conversation started. Stacy, can we turn to you first, maybe you and Janani to kick us off, to give us a couple examples of where you're working under this Backdraft space, and we'll go from there.
Great, thanks so much. You introduced the former and current Woodrow Wilson Fellows, so I was sort of hoping that you were going to say that I was a future Woodrow Wilson Fellow.
You got to bring that up with this one.
All right, it's really great to be here. So I'll make three big points sort of quickly that have been occupying some of my research and thinking time. And one of them, the first picks up on the work that we did in the Backdraft report, and I'm trying to carry forward. And that is to remind both researchers and policymakers that the things like the renewable energy economy and the high-tech economy are still the global economy that we have inhabited for some time. And what I mean by that is that when you look at where the raw materials come from for renewable energy and battery technology and these kinds of things, they still get mined. The extractive industries around the world still work very much like they have worked for quite a while, so that there are a lot of humanitarian, social, and environmental problems around them. And some kind of magic thinking sometimes among those of us who are climate-concerned folks that just because we're building a cleaner energy system with scenic windmills and these sorts of things, that we have somehow fixed the other parts of the economy, which leave people which leave many people behind and do them harm, I think is way too easy thinking. So I would focus on remembering that the new products, the giant new industries, the things that were promised about the about the decarbonizing world are still going to use a lot of the old commodity chains and produce a lot of the unfortunate outcomes. I'm also still quite interested in, and a topic that's really, I think, quite relevant lately, in what happens in the sort of the post-petro states and the post-petro geographies just generally. So if we succeed, in fact, in beginning to drive down oil consumption, what does that mean for the states and the people and the communities who are dependent on them? This overlaps, of course, with the challenge of coal, and we see it a lot. Two other things briefly. I don't want climate change mitigation and adaptation to drive out in our thinking the massive overuse of resources around the world and the massive sort of consumption of resources driven by kind of northern lifestyles. This too is leaving a lot of, this too in my view creates a lot of conflict potential. And so people in mining communities or people around who live in places very badly governed with lots of oil money lurking around, climate change is a much more distant threat to them, so if we need to make sure we don't avert our gaze too much. And then the last thing, the kind of challenge for climate and adaptation, and Jeff has heard me whinge on about this before, is that I really think we still, both in the policy communities and in academic communities, we are still bad at making climate change adaptation and mitigation policies that actually improve people's lives in the things that actually concern them. So whether you are in a rich place or a much poorer one, when you ask people, you know, what they're concerned about, you get remarkably similar answers often about jobs and economy and households and children and education and schools and potholes and public transport. Although I know that that's perfect in Washington, so you don't have to worry about that. But when you ask people what concerns them, I think one of the challenges for all of us who are climate concerned and climate policy focused is that we have to figure out how it is that adapting to the coming, to the changing climate and mitigating climate change actually also addresses the things that most citizens are concerned about because it isn't climate change.
Terry, thank you, Stacy. Janani, you could talk about some of the ways that you've tried to recognize, you know, acknowledging and recognizing the still mining intensive side and some of the work that you guys are doing with International Alert to try to mitigate that, shall we say.
Yeah, absolutely. No, I would definitely agree. We've been looking at the extractive sector, oil and gas, and how that affects conflict and environmental issues for decades, and yet this knowledge hasn't been transferred over to the renewable energy sector because I guess in part there's this assumption by the donors and by the companies that this is good, it's inherently good. But you know, if we look at something like hydro, it's hydro electricity generation, it's often seen as a very sensible investment. It, you know, you get this triple win, you're reducing climate change impacts by producing clean energy, you're supporting adaptation by maybe reducing flood risks, which are partly caused by climate change. You're also, in principle, supporting economic development. But if you're not looking at how you're doing this, you could also be simultaneously endangering downstream livelihood and food security, for example, by limiting access to and availability of water and potentially fish stock and things that people rely on to be carried by the water, like silt and the nutrients there that are required for farming. And this is particularly a risk in fragile states which are facing scarcity over water, uncertainty about water supply, and also where trade agreements and treaties, these historical treaties that are often in place, like, such as the Nile Water Treaty or the Indus Treaty, they're no longer really viable in the face of climate change, and in some cases they're not really legitimate anymore. So these are really important issues that need to be considered. Another really interesting example that we've touched on through our work in the northwest of Kenya in a state called Turkana is around wind power. And this is again something that seems like it should be fine. You're just getting energy from the air, from the wind, and yet, you know, these turbines are on land, and this land is often or governed by informal or traditional customary laws, so there's no clarity about who owns this land. So it's easy for investors to come in and build these turbines. The particular example was a large World Bank wind project called the Lake Turkana Wind Project, which stalled, investors pulled out. It was hugely costly, hugely embarrassing, and yet the conflict risks were very evident had they looked at this from a conflict sensitivity perspective. This was this was an initiative that needed to consult those people that use the land, and yet the consultation, the prior informed consent process, involved elites in Nairobi rather than, you know, Turkana, which was hundreds of miles away. There was no benefit sharing around the energy that would be generated from these turbines to try and put these communities, these nomadic pastoral communities, on the grid, and those affected communities were already highly armed pastoralist communities that were in conflict, and so this was, you know, you had all the pieces in place for this not to go well. So there's a lot of scope for bringing, for understanding the knock-on consequences of conflict on these processes, but also a lot of really positive opportunities to ensure that these investments in renewables can promote peace, because it does bring in investment, it brings the potential to bring energy to these communities. So that's just one example. Mm-hmm. That,
terrific. I think both of you make clear that in some ways things are not as different as we would have thought, right? And so face some of the same challenges. Yet what is also not different is sectors talking with one another. So the conflict people, the adaptation people, development people, that we're still operating in silos in counterproductive ways. And that field-based approach is one that we'll come back to in detail here in a moment. Before we do that, Ed, can you talk a little bit about, in some ways, the construction that on the one hand recognizes and moves past the kind of facile notion of climate causes conflict and has a more sophisticated version than that kind of gross simplification that gets often in the way in these discussions, yet still poses some challenges for getting down to this kind of example of fine grain analysis?
Sure. So if you look, and this, by the way, is drawing on the work of one of my PhD students, Daniel Abraham, so I'll give him credit for this. If you look at the discourse that sort of governs policy discourse, that governs how we think about the relationship between climate change and conflict, it's probably best captured in the phrase threat multiplier. That is to say that somehow climate change multiplies the threats to human well-being in various places. This is a significant challenge, though, for any sort of implementer or anyone working on this kind of issue, because it's an incredibly vague framing of the role that climate change plays. Upside, they're not saying climate change causes conflict. They're not saying climate change does something. Downside, in stepping back from that, it's become rather vague and difficult to program on. And I think one of the things this raises for me, and this speaks, I think, to what you're asking, Jeff, is the question of, it's a threat multiplier for who? And a threat multiplier via what pathway? And I think that we have to get at those kinds of things if we're supposed to be addressing the potential, we're talking about backdraft effects here, that is to the unintended conflict implications of some of the interventions we put in place to deal with climate change. I'll give you a quick example of the stuff I'm thinking about that illustrates what I'm talking about here. When we think about climate change adaptation, one of the things that you hear a lot about is the threat it poses to food security. And one of the places I'm doing a lot of work right now is in Mali, where we're looking at how to support various kinds of climate smart agricultural interventions, including providing weather and climate information to farmers. And, you know, in this kind of a setting, if you understand what's going on in a particular place, and if you drill down to a very, very local level, what you realize is that people's identities have an awful lot to do with the decisions that they make and how they see the world. So, for example, you might look at a climate model and see that this part of the world is getting warmer and it might be drying out. That is likely to pose very significant changes to agricultural production. So, hey, you should be addressing that by, for example, providing seeds that can deal with these conditions and boost yields. And you might want to bundle that, as some programs do, with greater market orientation. So have people, say, farm some sort of climate-resilient market, you know, cash crop. The problem is, in this part of the world, men define themselves as people who feed their families for the entire year, and that feeding the family is done by raising the food yourself. So if you grow the crop, sell the crop, and buy food, that actually counts as you being a failed farmer. You're not able to feed your family through your own production directly. And that creates a stress on men's identities, which means that they may or may not want to take this activity up. It could result in the breakdown of indigenous politics at the community level. Who gets to make decisions about how land gets used and what other kinds of decisions get made? You can see increases in intra-household conflict. You can see rising rates of domestic violence even crop up here. So these are some of the backdraft effects that we also have to worry about when we start asking about threat multipliers. For who and via what pathway?
Terrific. Well, sticking with that ground level discussion, one of the strong themes that came through in some of our conversations earlier today were ground up, but also really finding ways to grapple in very practical and place-based ways, ideas, you know, what lofty and some may say less specified notions of justice and equity and such. And so maybe Kim and Jesse, if you could talk about some of your very place-based research that still very much allows for us to draw some lessons out that give us things to look at that are perhaps beyond some of the headlines when we're often looking at climate security together.
After you.
Okay, great. So I was actually thinking I should have shared a story earlier today about how I came to the work that I do, which I actually think is a real example of backdraft. So I work primarily in forest governance and looking at the interactions between forest peoples and forest outcomes in mainland Southeast Asia. And I started saying early in my career, I don't want to work on climate change. Everyone's working on climate change. I don't want to do this. And then this new policy read, the reduced emissions from deforestation and degradation, was introduced. And at the time, I was working for the government of Laos in Southeast Asia, and I started to see the potential for conflict to arise as the result of this new policy mechanism, in the sense that forest governance in Laos has traditionally been undertaken at the community level. Laos has a very weak government, has very effective reach at times, but generally communities sort of drive resource decision making amongst themselves. With the introduction of RED, however, which has, if you're not familiar with it, it has very high levels of monitoring, reporting, and verification requirements. It's very technical. You have to be able to say this amount of carbon came from these particular trees that was conserved by these particular people, And without some sort of ownership of those resources, it's very difficult to decide who gets the benefits and who's responsible for ensuring that carbon sequestration takes place. And so the result of RED, at least in Laos, and they're still working out how this will play out, but part of the result has been a shift towards really defining new forms of property rights. And this means, in some cases, defining individual property rights, delineating land. But what has really happened is a dramatic shift away from sort of more flexible land use approaches where communities can rotate their crops based on their needs and based on current climate conditions to having very fixed properties. And as a result, a number of things have happened. And one is that community networks for conflict resolution have started to break down. And people are able to make claims, to lay claim to specific resources that they otherwise in the past wouldn't have been able to. And what we're seeing is actually reduction in adaptive capacity of these communities. So while, right, we think that RED, and I don't mean to say we should throw RED out, that's not what I'm saying, but while we think that RED can produce some really productive outcomes, both for climate and for forests and for people, the way that it's been approached thus far really reduces our imagination of how we might actually go about conserving forests. And so I just wanted to share that as right, that's how I came into this. And I think that in terms of justice, so really my work is looking at justice, and a lot of policymakers and I think it's a good thing, right, that we focus a lot on rights, justice, and equity, but we're very limited in how we're thinking about these things. And the case of RED is particularly problematic when we think about, well, you hear the debates, there's a lot of resistance to RED, particularly among indigenous groups. There's the No RED movement. They're very vocal. They're able to infiltrate climate negotiation processes. And the problem is that what they're demanding is not what's being heard by policymakers, right? So they're not demanding merely sort of equitable distribution of benefits, but it's really about recognition of difference, right? And so a lot of what I think we could do to move these RED debates forward is really start to think about the role of difference and the politics of difference and how we can embrace difference in a way that moves climate policy forward and perhaps minimizes the potential for backdraft to occur. I'm not sure if that's the answer, but it might actually open some debates while we're not trying to homogenize, but rather embrace difference as a way of enhancing dialogue and discourse.
Yeah, so our notion of rationality around some economic equalization or even conflict mitigation, as conflict is always bad, rather than what is perhaps, hopefully, we can pick up some of this notion of, at times, in some of these instances, having a little conflict gets you to a more equitable,
right,
more participatory outcome. And Jesse, that's certainly a space that you've worked in around participation and democracy around natural resource management and RED as well.
Absolutely. Kim's story is a good place to start because RED is a very complicated policy being implemented across most of the developing world, and it has some real issues. It's mandated to use free, prior, and informed consent and to represent local populations in decisions, and yet it doesn't. Mm-hmm. And so that recognition through representation, mm-hmm, we're finding is not happening for a variety of practical reasons, like democracy is slow, you don't get your results right away, but also that many of the people who are mandated to implement this don't have the knowledge to even know what or to be able to define local democracy in a way they could operationalize it or representation. So that's coming out of a 13 country case comparative study in sub-Saharan Africa of RED Plus and its implementation. And we found that in almost every case, local democracy, even where it was functional, was undermined and circumvented by projects trying to implement quickly. But I want to actually bring this around to another set of issues, which is you've got two issues in blowback. One is the effects of these policies, right? But then you have the causes of the problem that we're looking at, which Ed brought up, and how do we analyze them? If you look at the memo that was just put out by the White House, it's fabulous. And what I want to focus on is the best part of it. It's one little character, the hyphen that makes the compound adjective. The compound adjective here being climate-related damages, not climate damages, because there are multiple causes. And I'll tell a very quick story to illustrate this, because it's extremely important. And those memos, there are three documents, consistently use climate-related damages, climate-related impacts, weather-related damages. They really don't say climate damages or weather disasters ever. And that was, I thought, brilliant, because what it says is we understand that causality cannot be limited to climate change or climate events themselves. In April of 2015, April 18th, in the night, a boat sank off of Libya with somewhere between 750 and 950 migrants. They were labeled climate refugees. There were 28 survivors and only 24 bodies found. 200 of the missing young men, they were all young men, came from the villages I work in eastern Senegal, in Tambacounda. And I went and I spoke to their families, their parents, and it was one of the most painful series of interviews I've ever been involved in. And I asked them, what happened? Why did they go? What were they going from? Now, the New York Times and the UN were calling them climate refugees, okay? None of them mentioned climate. None of them mentioned weather. None of them mentioned crops. I've worked in this area for 30 years. I speak two of the local languages. They talked about quotas, permits, licenses. They talked about access to markets, access to representation. They did not talk about climate. And we need to bring their stories in, because they talked about the multiple ways in which they're exploited, put into relations of debt that are untenable. They talked about the loss of hope, hopelessness. And we're in a new era. I think it's a very interesting thing that there now is a hungry season there. And that hungry season, they don't see it as related to weather. So we have to ask them, what is it? And what should we be treating when climate is changing? There is more stress on agriculture. Perhaps the amount of food is less, maybe not. But in fact, there's enough to feed everybody. It's as if climate events, they take the cloud cover away and reveal a very unequal, very painful landscape that was produced by a long history of exploitation and distributional inequities. So with that, you read through the document that the White House produced, and they are very careful. Climate induced. They don't use the model that is predominant in the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change of hazards. The hazard comes along, boom, hits the community, everyone falls over. Implicitly, climate caused the damage, right? Instead, they're implying in that memo a vulnerability model, which says that there was a loss, we observed it, hunger or migration. It wasn't climate migration, it was migration. And we're going to look at the causes, and the causes are a set of events that range from the lack of political representation, which enables people to shape the political economy that shapes their well-being, to the policies that don't allow them to accumulate enough surplus wealth to buffer themselves against known events. So those are issues that we need to put on the table, and I think that that memo brings up, and I think across the board, the question of causality needs to be brought into modeling, and it has to be done through two means, but two means. The democratization of programs so that the voice of those local people who are affected gets into the design of policy, and the democratization of science. That is, models need to be put in place. climate change needs to be put in place through the integration of the observations of social scientists and historians who understand why people ended up on that cusp when the event happens to come along that everyone knew was coming. Thanks.
Thank you, Jesse. I kind of turn to you in part for that exotic bit that I promised, but also since your work connects very much in that realm, whether it's your work on water or your work in some of the UN institutions, perhaps you can, as I know you can, make a transition between this as well as some of these other things that feel like a very much a left turn, almost kind of giving up on these processes that we're identifying here.
Sure. So, so just briefly on that, and then I'll do a really, you know, fake segue into the geoengineering stuff. So I do a lot of work on water at a lot of different levels, do a lot of work on international and global dimensions of water, international water agreements, treaty law, and so on and so forth. Also at a very grounded level, in the summer, my graduate students and I go to the Middle East and we work with Israeli and Palestinian NGOs that are trying to do backyard scale gray water recycling in the West Bank, partly to show that people can cooperate across the conflict divide and partly to provide more usable water as a household level resource for people who don't have a lot of it. And one of the things that's become apparent to me from working at these different scales is that often what constitutes a solution at one scale simply exports the problem to another scale. And this is really apparent in the world of water and in the world of international water law. The problem that gets all of the attention in the climate and national security space is the problem of internationally shared river basins, upstream, downstream relationships. If Ethiopia builds a dam, Egypt is going to blow up the dam. There's some doubt that Egypt has the capacity to blow up the dam. It's also the case that Egypt has offered to invest in that very same dam that at other times they have threatened to destroy. So the problem is more complicated, even at just at the international diplomacy level, than simply a zero-sum game of upstream action and downstream reaction. But if Egypt and Ethiopia do find a way to cooperate around that, which I think the international system would consider a victory, and yet the solution is to put two of the world's five largest water storage devices, because the Aswan Dam is already in that basin, in the same basin, with only minimal coordination between them, that's a real-time experiment that's going to have dramatic consequences, and I would say significant conflict potential at lower levels of aggregation, at a catchment scale, at a community scale, at a household scale. And so often what looks like, I think one of the themes that's coming out of this panel for me is what looks like a cooperative solution at one level, if you're not doing kind of a multi-level system analysis. And a lot of what is driving climate action is at the higher levels. And so things like REDD+, they're coming out of the development regime. And a lot of times those kinds of solutions really have to be understood in terms of their multi-level consequences. Now the segue. One of the curious aspects of the Paris Agreement, which the parties to the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change reached at the end of last year, is that it combines very ambitious goals, surprisingly and happily, I think, ambitious goals. You know, we're going to hold it to 2C, and we're going to try to hold it to 1.5, with what is actually a very weak regime for doing so. It completely abandoned the Kyoto Protocol logic of targets and timetables, and it basically said, it reminds me of that old children's story of Stone Soup, right, where the town is going to make a giant meal, but then you've got to get everybody to start taking the turnips and potatoes and carrots that they were hiding out and somehow have them put it into the pot. Well, when you look at all the nationally determined contributions that countries have committed to, it is not enough, quite clearly, to meet the ambitions of the regime. And in fact, if you run the models, the suite of models that the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change refers to when it tries to put together a body of authoritative knowledge for decision makers, and you say, what's it going to take to hold the world to 2°C of warming, or even 3°C of warming? And you make the most ambitious assumption that IPCC is willing to make about mitigation, it's not enough. So there's a residual term other sources of affecting the climate, unnamed, that are called negative emissions, that sit in those models just to make the two sides of the equation balance. Now, some people would say that IPCC scenarios are not sufficiently aggressive and ambitious. They're conceding too much to the kind of political lethargy of the moment. We can do more with conservation. We can do more with renewables. So there are more ambitious scenarios out there. But you got to get pretty ambitious with those scenarios to get to the 2 or 3C over particular, let's say you model to 2050 or something like that. So that, in the wake of Paris, that is shining newfound attention on this residual category of negative emissions. And people are asking, well, what actually are negative emissions? And that is what is bringing geoengineering into the conversation. And this is something that has a great, I think, has a great deal of climate potential and needs to be handled very, very carefully. And we are not at the moment, I would say, organizing ourselves to have that conversation in the appropriate manner. So negative emissions refers to large-scale, regional, or even global-scale efforts to either remove carbon from the system or remove energy from the system. So you do something in the atmosphere to cut down on the heat load, or you take more carbon out to offset the carbon that you didn't mitigate and that you did, emit. In some simple modeling of the atmosphere sense, we know that this works, right? So if you simply do what's called sunshade engineering, you run the model and you put less heat in at the top of the model, well, we know on a first order effect that the planet's not going to warm as much. And if you continue to model and you look at the second order effects, the big feedback effects that we know are also part of the climate system, like cloud formation and like atmosphere-oceanic interactions and so on, indeed, not surprisingly, you do in fact get a cooler Earth. However, there are several obvious conflict risks that go with this sort of large-scale interventions in the planet, right? There's the problem of unintended consequences. This science is very abstract. It's very poorly understood. Just because you can make it work in a 3D model, or just because you can show in a lab-scale test that it works, every aspect of our learning about climate change has been surprise. Every time we find a new feedback effect and we understand the system in greater complexity, there's no reason to think those kinds of surprises won't encounter us in this space. And the unintended consequences could be quite great and could be quite severe. The possibility of rogue action. Just because we don't really know what we're doing and it's a bad idea does not mean that somebody will not do it out of desperation or out of, you know, the desire to capture profits and so on. And so when you start talking about things that might, you know, perturb the monsoonal patterns or have regional scale distributive kinds of consequences where the folks who are upstream may feel like it's a good thing, but the folks that are downstream may wind up paying the consequences, there's obvious climate conflict potential in that as well. And there's also the problem of capture, right? What if this agenda is rolled out by a relatively narrow scientific community of the sort that is today the folks that are doing most of the geoengineering kind of modeling and kind of theoretical development work on this at the moment? Who will guarantee that the learning stays broadly public? What about intellectual property rights in this space? There's a whole set of problems and questions there as well. The world is not currently prepared to think about this problem. If you think about it, half of the problem is analogous to something like the nuclear test ban treaty process, right, and these kind of large-scale environmental modification for which we do have a body of international law that could provide a reference. And the other half of the problem is more analogous to something like biotechnology or nanotechnology. It's the emergence of a new disruptive technology where we don't have any rules of the road. And yet we have a strong sense that we may need some rules of the road if this goes forward. We don't know who the national focal points are for an international discussion of this issue. The intergovernmental organizations in the UN have not had any kind of discussion of what's the appropriate division of labor among the specialized agencies. And so one's first instinct is to say, let's get our act together on this. Let's start doing some anticipatory development of norms. There have been some conversations about what are the appropriate principles that ought to guide research in the space. Those are useful conversations I think we can learn something from. But the problem is, there's another problem here, and that's the problem of moral hazard. The very act of preparing ourselves to regulate geoengineering also starts to stand up for use geoengineering. And there's a great fear, and I think not an unwarranted fear, that as we start to think about what would normally be the right reaction, anticipatory governance around geoengineering, the danger is it may start to look like a simple, cheap, for people who believe you can pull planetary levers, which, you know, no one said that up here, quite the contrary, right? But there is that out there, right? And so there's a great danger that it starts to undercut the hard, necessary work of mitigation and adaptation that we're still trying to move forward. So the great challenge that we face is that we've got to figure out a way to start having an intelligent conversation about the science of this, about the impact assessment of this, about the risk assessment and the conflict risk assessment of this, but we've got to do it in a way that it doesn't push it forward as a sort of a false alternative to the hard work of dealing with climate change.
Terrific, thank you, Ken. Josh, now with a series of big integrated projects, you've been developing, looking at lots of variables, putting them together and developing maps that try to help us orient to place. If you could talk a little bit about those projects, and then also, as you commented earlier today, about the challenge and the importance of connecting them to some of those very specific place-based research efforts, putting it in place, as Jesse said, as you move forward on multiple fronts in this topic area.
Sure, I'll try it. I had some thoughts and reactions to some other folks, and I'll try and link it back to this research. I sometimes worry that the climate and security community is a bit like a dog chasing a car, and then now that with the memorandum that's come out, we caught the car, so now what? Is the increased attention to climate security an unalloyed good? And, you know, I'd say, you know, does it lead us to discussion mostly about ourselves, you know, our vulnerability of our bases, our supply chains, sort of operational battlefield context? And those things are important, don't get me wrong, but I kind of worry that if our sort of amplitude of our vision gets narrowed to that, we've kind of lost something in the discussion. On the other hand, you know, if we keep that wider ambit in our sights, what if we did pay more attention? Are there risks our efforts could be potentially counterproductive if done badly? So say, for example, concern about climate change leads us to renewed concern, as we've already heard, about transborder or transboundary water sharing and sort of potential flashpoints for conflict. And you know, we know historically that many of those disputes have been resolved peacefully, but you know, in a future world in which there's increased water scarcity, will the future be like the past? And you know, agreements that we already know exist, for example, for the Indus and the Nile, we know those are under strain, as we've already heard today. But there are other basins, particularly in Africa, which are under-institutionalized, which lack the kinds of cushions and mediating devices that have kind of kept these conflicts at bay in other areas. So would U.S. efforts in particular to try to head off conflict be productive? Would they be helpful? Would they be welcome by the players? Or would they displace, you know, if they were supported by outside efforts, would they displace conflict to another level, as Ken suggested? If the U.S. can play a constructive role, what interventions would be helpful? What unique capabilities and knowledge do we have? What do we know from our previous experience about counterproductive, unanticipated consequences of action? For example, the U.S. is helpful in Afghanistan in finishing or restoring some dams that in turn created tensions with neighboring Iran. And what lessons can we draw from that experience? Now, there may be some lessons that we draw that in certain circumstances our efforts would be entirely counterproductive because we're not seen as a helpful neutral arbiter. So what other efforts or what other players would be beneficial? You know, there's a term out there that's in international relations about powerful actors laundering their own actions through international organizations. And the word laundering has unfortunate connotations, but on some level, you can moot the resistance to U.S. policies by working through multilateral agencies for whom their actions, whether it be the World Bank or others, might be perceived as more legitimate. So how does this link back to the agenda of, Jeff asked me about in terms of our research? We've been doing sort of composite vulnerability maps of the places that we think are most likely to experience really negative climate security related outcomes, first in Africa, and increasingly we've turned our attention to South and Southeast Asia. And we're combining maps and indicators of physical exposure, population, household and community resilience, and governance, because it is, as we've heard in other aspects of the discussion today, that it's a complex, multi-causal, that physical processes alone don't drive it, these outcomes. And one of the challenges is that our sets of maps are just one among many. And so the challenge for policymakers who are busy and trying to figure out how to focus their attentions is, you know, do any of these provide an accurate portrait of what they should be worried about? Different maps speak to different kinds of impacts. Some are concerned about impacts on livelihoods. Some are concerned about impacts on human life. Some are concerned about the conflict potential. And I think there's a dizzying array of information out there, and it's difficult to know how to prioritize, to think about, you know, is every problem in the world something that we care equally about? I mean, do we care about all, who is the we, and do we care about all places equally? If not, we have to think about other dimensions of concern that feed into our perspective. Is it, you know, an area of strategic importance to us, whoever the us is? And one of the challenges, I think, for the climate security community of people who are trying to make the case that this is an important issue for U.S. national security is that they start to try to internalize some sense of what are the places that the U.S. cares about, and then they start sort of potentially inflating the threat to wrap it around the current preoccupation with the Middle East and terrorism. And I think that is potentially problematic. And so I think one of the real challenges we have in this space is how do we step back from, you know, things that are an effort to get the issue on the agenda and have some, to the extent that there is an honest assessment of what the true strategic importance of different places on the planet are and what our constructive, productive role in it could be. How do we marry those concerns in a way that is likely to make problems better, not worse?
Thank you. Excellent, Josh. I think a variety of points there, and through the panel, with all of you having made a comment, I think a number of places you're suggesting greater level of complexity, some of the assumptions that we have we shouldn't bring to the table, or at least it narrows the vision and needs to be broader. One that we had a chance to get into a little bit and kind of throw it open to who would like to take it on, but this notion of the presumption that conflict is always negative to be minimized. We kind of get around it a little bit to talk about conflict-sensitive interventions and see the value in that, but then some of you also talked about very resilient systems in which a little conflict would actually help out a lot. And so the productive notions of conflict. Kim, you're nodding. Would you like to give us a few examples of that?
Yeah, thanks. That's right. So I was trying to think, I didn't touch at all on this notion that there's a lot of peace building potential in things like red through sort of the productive use of conflict, right? If we think about regional stability, and caring about vulnerable communities and the role that that vulnerable communities play in both enhancing our natural environment, but also as global citizens, then we can think about interventions like Red Plus through free, prior, informed consent, some version of it, right, that may work, as an opportunity to think about building greater citizenship and sort of global legitimacy around global common concerns, right? And so for when I think about conflict in especially in oppressive regimes, conflict can often be a really healthy signal that change is coming, right, towards more democratic approaches, towards more legitimacy, towards more empowerment of a broader base of constituencies than those who have traditionally been in power in these particular places. And so I think there's a lot to be said for not to deflect full attention away from more technocratic responses to global environmental change and stressors that impact these communities, but really embracing the political opportunities and challenges that reside in these countries as a way for really enhancing adaptive capacity, because ultimately, at the end of the day, the people who can make decisions about how they respond to stressors are individuals. And that the better empowerment they have and the more control over their lives that they have, the better decisions they can make in those contexts. And, I don't think anyone wants Big Brother breathing down their neck all the time saying, you should, you know, when the flood comes now, you should go here, right? You should be able to make that decision. But the only way that you'll continue to sort of amass capacity to make decisions is through self-empowerment and the ability to take place in these spaces. I feel like that's very abstract, but.
Yeah. Jesse, although I do think it is important to have Big Brother breathing down our necks. In the most positive sense, we need to bring government back in, because it is the responsibility of government to protect people from these kinds of hazards that are at scales that people might not be able to. And that's part of the political economy of damage.
Right.
Oftentimes, we explain damage because we expected that some institutions would help avert it, but also because people were exploited and pushed to the margins without government interventing and helping, to the point at which they were so poor that they were easily damaged mm-hmm. by what is an expected climate event.
Mm-hmm. Ken and Ed and Janani?
So just a very tangible example from the space that I work in water is large dams. If you look at how a large dam is typically constructed today compared to how it would have been built 30 years ago, large dams are often environmental nightmares. They're often human rights nightmares. They're often problematic. That said, I completely understand why Ethiopia would like to be able to store more water. They have a desperate need to store more water, and I understand why they want to do it. And some sort of, you know, catching of water is going to be necessary if they're going to store water and give themselves some greater resilience. But setting aside the question of whether or not a dam should be built, if you look at the norms around how it will be built today versus 30 years ago, it'll be better today. There will be more attention to the fact that that dam may do some downstream damage that we can't model today. So the best practices today would be to set aside a fund that people can appeal to be compensated if they lose some of their farmland because of the way the channel cuts in the river or something along those sorts of lines. I'm not saying that we have perfected it, and I'm not saying I'm a big fan of really large dams, because neither of those would be the case. But the question is, to the extent that it's done better today, why is it done better today? It's because of conflict. It's because of contention. It's because people figured out how to marry site-specific protests, which have been going on since the Romans started building dams, to a broader, very aggressive, very conflictive transnational network of environmental and human rights activists who engaged and contested and kind of blew the doors off of the more polite conversations among experts and financiers about how dams ought to, in fact, be constructed. And so conflict is ubiquitous in this space. We're talking about changing land use. We're talking about disruptive infrastructure. We're talking about extractive industries. Whether you're talking about doing that to extract a resource or to protect a fragile ecosystem, you're talking about significant interventions. And conflict is going to be ubiquitous. And so the challenge is to tap that energy, channel it in a productive direction through the right kinds of institutions.
So one thing I want to do is just pick up on and actually maybe take some of the discussion about conflict, its constructiveness or destructiveness, and drive it down to that really, really local sub-household even scale. And just to kind of remind everybody that at least in the social sciences, we long ago abandoned sort of functionalist framings of society, right, where they are stable, self-reinforcing things that don't get changed unless something from outside comes in and pokes them and causes some kind of change. We know that societies and cultures, that they change, the dynamic things, that in fact, stasis is the thing that needs to be explained. And understanding how you fix norms and how those get maintained over time is really the important question, and how difference within that gets managed or controlled. What that means fundamentally is, if we get down to these scales, that conflict's always there. There's always, if you need to control something, if you need to manage change, you are working out some kind of tension or conflict between different actors in society. So the question is not if there is or is not conflict. I think none of us up here, I think, would be framing it that way. The real question, or questions maybe, is what does conflict mean in a given context to those who are experiencing that conflict? Who is experiencing that, and in what ways? And where is that conflict going? What is happening with that? And I think that when we're talking about all these larger scale things, we have to remember that often, not always, because I do agree with things that Ken and Jesse have said about larger entities like governments and other organizations matter a lot, but a lot of the stuff we see that's conflict is actually aggregated up from some of these micro level conflicts that are always there all the time, and that our adaptation and mitigation type interventions intersect with and can exacerbate or ameliorate.
Yes, just to pick up on the conflict being, well, it's not conflict that's the bad thing, it's violent conflict, and so understanding how to address those root causes of conflict and avoid it being violent, being the core of what avoids the backdraft issue. Just an example from some of the work we've just been doing in an informal settlement called Kibera in Nairobi, Kenya. Here, there was violent conflict between two groups of, well, multiple groups, but particularly two ethnic groups, where youth from, particularly young men in these groups, they felt that access to jobs, already scarce, was based on political affiliation. And we could see that this had become violent during the elections in 2007 and 8, very, very bloody, in fact. However, there was an intervention that we were examining, and this was a scheme initiated by the president's office, so it was highly politicized, and you know, if there was this perception that jobs were based on political affiliation, with one of the predominant ethnic groups, Kikuyu, being affiliated with the government and the other being affiliated to the opposition, this was very interesting to look at, how they could potentially mitigate these conflict drivers, and or at least address the conflict and reduce the risk of violence. And they did so surprisingly effectively by bringing all parties around the table, so to speak. They were all involved. They were all brought in through consultation, through decision-making processes. And the outcome of this, it led to change. There was conflict because there aren't enough jobs for everyone. But the process through which they could, these jobs were allocated, were then participatory. There was transparency. There was actually not only jobs as a byproduct of this project, but there was increased trust in each other, but also in the political regime. So there was a strengthened kind of social contract. It wasn't in any way ideal, but it was very interesting to see that this process got the buy-in of people, so that it then did very visually reduce conflict because the next election was not violent. There were multiple other reasons at play, but this was an interesting factor. And then the climate change resilience building co-benefit there was that these youth, looking at what their issues were and what, yes, they wanted livelihoods and they needed to do something useful, they wanted to address this water and sanitation problem, which was one of the key risks of flooding in their community. And then just on the point about needing to bring governance in, I think that was a micro level governance thing, because this was working with the municipal government. It was very interesting to observe the need, very, very evident need to bring in the role of government, even if they are doing something, in the floods, in the flood response in Sindh, in Pakistan, in 2010-11. We just happened to be there doing our research, looking at vulnerability to flood risks, and people's responses were so strongly anti-government, even though we could see they were Navy ships, they were Navy boats, providing relief to those, you know, getting people who were on islands or stuck in trees. People's response were, look, the government's doing nothing, they don't care about us, you know, we are marginalized, they don't care about us. So the narrative there, partly because the international development community was so strong, the humanitarian community was so visible, the backdraft there was that the government had become invisible, and that had, even though they were doing something, the perception was that they're not, and that weakened the social Absolutely. Contract. And somewhere like Sindh and that part of Pakistan, anything that's reducing kind of the social contract needs to be addressed. So that was a very interesting observation there.
Tess, did you want to?
Yeah, we see exactly that often, where projects come in to local communities, mm-hmm. provide services that local government is mandated to provide by the state, and therefore they become illegitimate. Nobody goes to them, they have nothing offered to the people, and they're said to be, see, they're doing nothing. And that's partly because the monies that went to these projects and programs should have gone to the local government, according to even law. So you get this problem of the delegitimation of the state. Mm-hmm. The other point is that I want to just say is all policy is redistributive. There are winners and losers. Win-win is a kind of a rare thing. The world that we live in is not Pareto optimal. And so leaving policy to a kind of market-driven governance instead of government-framed approach, I think, has these kinds of backdrafts.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's interesting stuff, attempting to ask you some more questions, but I'm also mindful we have a lot of folks who we want to bring into this conversation. And so when it works for you to respond to those questions vis-a-vis the presidential memo and other things that we talked about discussing, I urge you all to do it. But why don't we turn it over to questions? We have some microphones that we will bring to you, because today's event is being webcast and the video will be archived, so we want to hear your questions on there. If you could let us know who you are, where you're coming from, and a quick question so that we can gather some and give folks a chance to respond. So, yeah, right there in the back, yeah, in the middle. Right there. Yep, great.
Thank you. I'm Dave Rabinowitz, I'm retired. And I'm a little concerned about over attribution of causation of problems to climate change. For example, Jesse gave the example of a hungry season showing up in Senegal. And part of that could be attributable to climate change, but for more than 50 years, the population of Senegal has been growing by more than 30% per decade. In 1960, the population was about 3 million. In 2010, it was about 12.5 million. Today, it's about 15.5 million. And that probably played some part in the generation of a hungry season. And my concern is, if you attribute too much of the causation to climate change and then do some mitigation, you may be very disappointed with the results, and you may end up losing credibility. Are people taking that into account?
Well, I think you'll find a very sympathetic panel here. Hopefully that was part of what came across. Would anyone like to, Ken, make that clear?
Yeah, I think a good example of that is the way that Syria has been discussed in terms of drought and climate change. And so if you go through the exercise now of saying, what would early warning have looked like in the context of Syria, and just set aside the drought climate connection, because, you know, droughts occur for a range of reasons. No, but let's just stipulate that we're pretty confident that the wet are going to get wetter and the drier are going to get drier is kind of the first order rule of thumb of climate change, and drought's a problem. Well, the drought in the region, which has been, you know, multi-year and pretty pernicious, it didn't affect only Syria, right? The reason why, first of all, I think that the causes of conflict in Syria are complex and not primarily related to climate change and not even primarily related to drought. That's just my sense. Not a Syria expert, but that's my sense. But what would you have had to know to see the drought signature and how it then worked its way causally through the system? You'd have to know that the government of Syria had cut subsidies pretty dramatically for farmers as part of its economic adjustment and marketization kinds of programs, for which it received a good deal of international praise. You'd have to know something about the way that irrigation rights were distributed, the way the regime used irrigation as part of the process of rebuilding its authority. You'd have to know about the tensions between large holder and small holders around irrigation processes. You'd have to know the history of Syria's poor choices with regard to water policy and water resources management leading up to that period. And then the drought is not insignificant in that context, but it is in no way causally determinative or the driver. I mean, we just have to get away from that sort of a language. So I think, you know, I'm in much sympathy with the point. I'd be careful of using population as another single punch kind of stand-in driver, which that's not where you were going, but we have to think in terms of, you know, necessary and sufficient conditions and complex causality and the dependent variables and the independent variables, the arrows are going both ways on most of the significant relationships, and do a kind of a dynamic analysis through that.
Josh, you want to?
Yeah, I think trying in single cases to try and determine the relative causal weight is fraught. And I've been, this might be, Thomas Homer Dixon has written a lot about this in the past in the early debates on environmental security in the 1990s, and he kind of gave up on that enterprise. And I'm working on a new book where I want to explore that question. But, you know, the thing that he basically said at the time is, you know, if you're looking for a particular security outcome and question, whether it's violent conflict or something else, you know, going back to the Syria example, would you have gotten conflict were it not for the drought? Like it's neither a necessary nor sufficient question, but if you take that away, would you have had, like, is it, because you can get conflicts without drought, right? The drought itself wasn't sufficient to cause the conflict, but can we understand that particular episode without the drought? And I think that's still a useful way to think about this particular. Now, maybe overdetermined that Syria was bound to blow up at some point, and whatever the sort of ultimate trigger was, you know, it happened to be drought in this case, but it was going to blow up. But I really don't know that about this particular case. And so as we try and go through cases around the world, I think that's the kind of interrogation that we need to ask ourselves and do these sorts of paired comparisons. Why does Syria blow up, but neighboring countries like Lebanon don't, if they experienced a similar physical exposure? Or why did Somalia's famine happen in 2011, but Ethiopia was better able to cope? And I think that's a productive way to think through this problem, but we may not ever be able to satisfactorily determine in these sorts of small n cases of what the relative causal weight of one factor compared to another.
And I think, and for context on that too, I think part of the argument is have it be part of the discussion rather than absent, right? So it's a much more modest ask, which is take these issues, in this sense, threat multiplier works to try to say it needs to be something considered, but just like the important hyphens in terms of it's in the new presidential memorandum, that dash means that there's a whole lot going on. And so the challenge becomes when it becomes a bumper sticker, an advocacy statement that suggests unicausality or even the most important variable or a kind of a proximity that runs afoul of attribution and all sorts of other additional factors. That's what then becomes problematic when it's the simplified version. Of course, simplified is what this town likes, right? And so the challenge is start the conversation with a simple, but you better get to some of this complexity or you're going to not have correct diagnosis and productive response.
Yeah, I think this is a really important point. I would never have implied that the drought caused the problems, nor population. This is an area that's water rich, and there's a history of not investing in bringing that to people for a variety of reasons that I would say were as causal. You can't put weights on these things in some relative sense, but you can bring them into the history and understand where potential levers for change are. And I think you have to think in the Syria case, too, of the drought as having come after a history of placing people on a certain precarious margin. And the drought was a trigger that pushed them over the edge. It did not cause their precarity. It didn't cause their vulnerability. That has to be understood. But if you take it as a static situation, yeah, it's true. The drought came, hit them, and they fell over or migrated out. That's not an analysis. So exactly, keeping the components and the histories that we do know in the story is incredibly important for identifying potential solutions.
Okay, some other questions? Smart people in the room. Let me ask you guys a question then. Anybody grappling in very practical terms with this presidential memorandum and how they or folks they're working with are dealing with this issue? Yes, Sherry, I am looking at you.
I'm going to pull you back to the first.
Okay, discussion. Give you a microphone.
I am Sherry Rosenblum from CNA, the executive director of the CNA Military Advisory Board. So this whole idea of how do we talk about climate change in the framework of conflict is a difficult question. It's one that we've been grappling with right now in a water security study as well as in an energy security study. Maybe it's more of a comment for the panel. One of the questions that I really have is it's easy to also discount it back too much, where you say, oh, well, we've never seen this kind of conflict, or we've never experienced, we're never going to be able to pull out and quantify what these factors are going to be. And then you can end up kind of discounting it back to zero. So maybe it's a question back to the panel is how do you not discount it back to a zero value while at the same time be able to prepare yourself, particularly when trying to think about risk, in terms of how do you think about that really moving forward in a way that is a non-zero value for some of these factors? And when you really don't know what the future is going to hold, you don't know what the black swan effects are going to be, you don't know how some of these climate impacts are truly going to manifest 30, 40 years down the line. And if you're talking about developing risk profiles, how do you incorporate some of this? So, and I don't have an answer to this, it's just more of a, let me turn it back, of I appreciate the need for caution, but at the same time, I also want to not lose the risk that these kinds of stressors actually could provide in a world of increased affluence and increased population and climate. So thanks.
Yeah. That was a long being open question. But being open to the future not looking like the past, and how do you take account of that, Ed?
So it's a good question, and one that actually we were talking about earlier, I think, in a lot of ways. And actually, your use of the phrase black swans to me is a useful jumping off point, because I'm a qualitative social scientist. Like, I built my career sitting in villages talking to people. And I think a couple of us on this panel did that. And I have found that there are an awful lot of events that people call black swan events that I knew were coming, because I sat in a village and I talked to people. And so that really comes to the question of what data and what evidence, and this is something we were talking about earlier, what data and what evidence gets included when we have these sorts of discussions. Specifically, for me, and it's a little bit self-interested, but I also believe, I do this kind of work because I believe in the value of it, how do we get more of this fine-grained qualitative work into these kinds of conversations, just into these models, into all this kind of stuff? Because that work, and you know, the evidentiary standards for it get confusing for people who may not be familiar with qualitative work and you're used to quantitative analysis and that kind of thing. But we're pushing too much of that out, at least this is my personal opinion, in a lot of these conversations. Too much of this stuff disappears, and then people act surprised when stuff happens. Meanwhile, a bunch of us who've been looking at this stuff on the ground go, that wasn't surprising. We could have told you if anyone had asked or listened. So I think that there's a real question of what evidence we're using here, and that shapes the value of this information and how it does or doesn't get discounted.
Ken?
Yeah, I mean, it's a great question. It's the question, and I don't have a great answer, but a couple of things that I think would be part of that answer. There's a fundamental difference between optimizing and managing risk. And I think we have got to have a paradigm shift toward managing risk by first just admitting that it is that uncertain sort of landscape. So, you know, putting all your eggs in one basket is a great decision strategy if you know all the parameters of the situation. But when you don't, you know, you have to take a more probabilistic kind of an approach. And in a lot of these cases, what we really need to do is we need to say, you know, what are the, not the what's the cause, but what are the seven or eight kind of key parameters that come together in this situation, all of which are uncertain, all of which have a plausible range of future values, not it'll be war, it'll be peace, but, you know, the 30% chance will be war, we don't know. But we need to start working with those kinds of ranges. And then you got to run the thing 10,000 times. And you see that 72% of the time, this is probably a bad idea. We need to let that kind of thinking inform our decisions. A second thing is we have to start putting a real price, a value on flexibility. If you conclude that the water and energy needs of this place, and you have a good stakeholder dialogue and everybody agrees, we need 1,000 megawatts of generating capacity and we're going to build a big hydro or something like that, right? Well, what are the odds that 50 years from now, looking back, we're going to be glad that we did that, right? The ability to change your mind about that 10 years down the road and move in a slightly different direction as you gain information in these complex systems, that has an increasing positive price and value on it, right? You build a big pile of concrete, you better get it right, because that's what you've got for the next 50 years, and there's not that many modifications that you can make. And so this idea of approaching this as kind of a problem of managing risk in an inherently uncertain world, and within that, preserving flexibility, the logical corollary of which, to me, is kind of decentralization and pursuing a range of options, I think those have got to be parts of the decision toolkit.
Josh. So I wanted to think about if we can identify what constellations of factors or variables lead to bad outcomes. You know, and so we may not be able to make point predictions about particular places, but we know that the certain configurations and constellations of things coming together often produces, in a general sense, very bad outcomes. So Aaron Wolf at Oregon State basically said, when you look at transboundary water basins, you can look at two factors. You know, is there water scarcity on the physical side, and has one of the states in the river basin taken unilateral action, maybe to dam a river or to do some infrastructure that that hasn't consulted with their neighbors? And from those two factors alone, he's pretty confident that if you survey all of the river basins around the world, you can identify potential problem situations with those two factors. And that's based on, you know, I don't know, 20 years of work in this space. And I think we could do that kind of early warning analysis that then could, maybe it will or it won't, but we could at least identify the 10 or 15 or 20 river basins around the world that we ought to be worried about. And we might be, we've done similar work like that with famine, with the famine early warning systems. And we may need to step back a bit and think about more systematic, you know, sources that lead to disenfranchisement and people, you know, not having their needs met by their state or international donors that feed into those sort of seasonal forecasts. But we have, you know, now iSciences generates a water anomalies, you know, kind of monthly forecast. That's just on the physical side, but we need to pair that with the social science side of other dimensions that contribute to potentially bad outcomes. And I think Aaron Wolf's work in this space is instructive.
Stacy.
Yeah, I think just really quickly, coming a little bit back to the title of the session, Sherry, I think the other thing is that we want to figure out where we are in the politicization of climate change generally, right? So for many people who've spent 20 or 30 years trying to get climate to arrive high enough on the political agenda to do something about it, it seems to me that over the last few years, well, there's much, much more to be done on mitigation and adaptation, of course, but we now see that climate politics are very high politics, right? Bigger money is being spent. We're talking about trillions of dollars for adaptation. So in my view, that it's partly because because climate is becoming a thing that powerful economic actors and more powerful states are putting more resources into, it precisely is the moment where we have to remind ourselves that what we do can also be dangerous, right? And that's true of anything that suddenly, right, is much higher on the political agenda. And so that's been the way that I've been thinking about our own kind of research transitions and policymaking transitions, that, you know, if it's true that 70 or 80 or $100 trillion will be spent on these kind of estimates that people are doing with adaptation, imagine what kind of actors in the world $70 trillion attracts. I mean, let's just be honest with ourselves, right? So this is, I think, why we have to acknowledge that as political momentum to do things grows, some of the things we could do could go very, very badly, and things have gone badly in local scale projects, and we could scale the bad up. There's no doubt about this, right? So I think that's kind of how it's been occupying my thinking a little bit.
Okay, there's a gentleman here, and then Roger Mark has a question.
Thank you. I'm Paul Randolph with Palladium, and I just kind of bring it back maybe a little bit to the Red Plus discussion, and I think it also ebbs into some of the other comments today. Seems like you've had a couple themes that came up that challenges some of the implementation of Red Plus. One being kind of, has there been enough time given when they start up those programs to look at the political economy and analyzing and understanding that local political economy analysis that's needed to be done, and secondly is kind of the behavior change, cultural understanding of the cultural environments, and how do you, if you need to bring about some type of behavior change, how would you incorporate that? I think in other fields of development, particularly in health, global health programs, behavior change, communication, and how you look at that type of programming, incorporating that into your designs and implementation of those programs is fairly well established over the last, you know, 3 decades plus. Are you seeing that being allowed or coming into some of the implementation that you've researched in Red Plus? And then also that time, why is there not enough time being given to have that political economy analysis up front to understand the local governance structures, whether it's in a community level or district level or a national level, to make sure you've accommodated that?
Those are great questions, and I'll answer the first part first, and that's this question of behavioral change, and I don't know if I'm interpreting your question right, so correct me if I'm wrong, but what I think I heard is that in the context of Red Plus, we need to change the behaviors of people who are deforesting and degrading forests, and that's what Red Plus is incentivized to change. Is that, yeah. Okay, so, and I ask that because there's been over the last 30 years a huge emphasis on sort of putting the drivers of deforestation as being local communities who are the ones being impacted by Red Plus. But in the regions where I work, the data show that the drivers of deforestation are actually these large global market forces, and local communities themselves are not equipped or able to resist the deforestation pressures that are coming in, and in fact may try to resist those, but governments are granting land concessions or forest concessions, and so in that sense the behavior change through Red Plus is perhaps being misdirected, and that it needs to be directed towards the consumers that are driving, right, demand for these forest products or for the agricultural products that are then grown on these lands or biofuel or whatever, as well as towards the large sort of agricultural industries that are shifting these. And so in that sense, I think Red is missing the mark. It's misdirecting who needs to be changed. And then the second part of the question was on this implementation. So why is there not enough time in terms of consultation? And I mean, there's probably a very complex sort of long answer to this. My simple answer would be that the way that most bilateral and multilateral donors work on very short turnaround frames that don't actually allow for consultation or local involvement in siting or decision-making practices, and that communities are only first consulted once the project has already been designed and decided upon. And so the donor model is not really working for a lot of these communities. But that's an, it's more complex, but that's my simple sort of response.
I would agree with that, and I think there are a lot of reasons that these programs don't give the time, the incentive to the donor to get something implemented quickly. The fact that the process that you'd have to go through, like working with representative authorities, would take a lot longer and might say no. So the very fact of consent is something that many of these intervening agents will, they'll go to the people who will say yes, which means they won't go to representative bodies. They'll go to subsections of the population. Oh, forest-dependent people. Well, the forest doesn't belong to just the people who use it. Mm-hmm. It's the whole community, ostensibly. So there's a lot of mismatches. But when you begin explaining the situation and getting people involved in understanding the amounts of money involved, then you get problems of people saying, well, why are we getting so little? You're paying us because we live at subsistence in a low-income country. You're going to pay us not to use our forests at this terribly low level while others are making more, so you get tension there. The projects I study in eastern Senegal, two donor agencies, big ones, funded the training of local people to cut forests for charcoal as part of forest management. They did not want any part of cutting their forests, but it was all part of the idea, you know, that they're going to save them if you make them valuable, which didn't turn out to be the case either. So there's a lot of ideological overlays in what constitutes an incentive to save a forest, mm-hmm. whether the financial one does it, even when it's exploitation or
so. I just think that both of these points raise something, and actually the issue of behavior change, a phrase that honestly in development when used makes my skin crawl, because of all the things that were just pointed to about whose behavior and all those sorts of things. But this lurks underneath, and Jesse's example there also really plays into this. We think a lot about, especially under climate change type work, but under development more generally, we talk about do no harm principles, but do no harm presumes you know enough to not do any harm. It presumes you have the information and the data to understand how you're intervening and with whom and in what way. And I would argue that in an awful lot of these situations that we're looking at, Jesse's case is a great one right there. The presumption was that this couldn't make things worse, and surely maybe it'll make them more valuable, but that's a misunderstanding of that context and then their ideological overlays, et cetera. And the outcome is not no harm, the outcome is harm. We don't intend to do harm with these, but this is, to me, core to this entire concept of sort of backdraft, right? That what we're doing for climate change adaptation and climate change mitigation is not inherently do no harm, because we don't know enough to be sure that's the case.
You don't think what have you got to lose is a good slogan?
Make backdraft great again.
We're dealing with a lot of people who have nothing to lose, and that's the problem. And when they... when things go wrong, they're in deep trouble.
Yep. For me, the key focal point would be what are the necessary conditions for people to have agency? Mm-hmm. And knowledge could be a limiting factor on that, but it often is not the limiting factor. And so an interesting example. So 2010, 2011, the UN General Assembly concluded that there is, in fact, a human right to water. So it's soft law, but a General Assembly declaration and so on. And that had a strong impact on the last phase of the Millennium Development Goals, which were from 2000 to 2015, and we're trying to cut water deprivation percentage terms globally in half. So the World Health Organization was doing this annual survey on progress toward the Millennium Development Goals and so on, and they would survey governments, and you get a lot of governments responding, a lot of really interesting data in there. So one year, they asked a question, they asked two questions, they asked a bunch of questions, these two. Do your citizens have a constitution or otherwise strong legal right to water? And has there ever been a court action trying to you know, manifest that right or enforce that right? And the answer fit into three piles. At one end of the spectrum were governments that said there is no legal right to water in our polity. And at the other end of the spectrum, there is a legal right, and there has been at least one court action. The single biggest set of responses was the ones that said, there is a legal right, there has never been a court action. And one of the governments, I'm not going to name which one, but one of the governments, this small, impoverished country, had written in the margins, it seems our people are not aware of their rights. That's one possible explanation for why there's never been a court action, but it seems to me, you know, the ability to use that right is probably the limiting factor in that case. So I do think I think the behavioral thing for me is to focus on the requisite conditions for agency, with knowledge being one element of it, and at times plausibly these are complicated problems, you know, the limiting element, but quite frequently not.
And representation is another big element.
Thanks, Jeff. Two very quick questions for the panel. So I was quite struck by Stacy's comment in the beginning, where he said that you're working in these communities where climate change is a more distant threat for them. I wonder if you could deconstruct that a little bit more and talk about whether the fact that we are having our dialogue today all around climate change, is that a disservice? Is it presenting a problem when you're seeing this disconnect with the communities that you're working with? And last year at the Planetary Security Conference in The Hague, we were looking at climate change and security, and I led the sessions on Africa, and we did a simulation with folks in the room. And folks in the room got it. They said, this is great. All of the diplomats in the room said, help. What I need is very concrete, specific diplomatic tools. For those of us who are looking at the presidential memorandum, what are there in terms of very concrete, specific tools for development, for the federal departments, for the diplomatic community that we can be looking at? How can we help in that regard?
Sure. Very briefly, I think. I think all conversations start from a place, right? So I don't think it's necessarily wrong or bad to have a climate change frame discussion. I think what we. I think in terms of climate change and security, what I heard a lot of today from people's very, very fantastic and varied research and discussions, was that that if we remember that many, many things make people insecure, that when we start thinking about how climate change connects in terms of designing policies and interventions, here I'm thinking about that, that you start from a place that actually is a conversation about both climate change and security. At UMass Boston, my colleague Paul Kirshen has been organizing community dialogues and stakeholder sort of planning exercises around some of the most disenfranchised neighborhoods and communities of Boston. And he readily starts all of these by saying, you know, something like, well, look, powerful people like the governor and other people, they're interested in climate change. So I got money to come talk to you about what you're interested in. So let's bring our community dialogue together, and we're going to stay here for several years. We've got money to keep doing this. And so I'm saying I'm going to bring maps about the neighbor, about water in the neighborhood. I'm going to bring maps about sea level rise and risk and where people live, because I think this is really important. But actually, we are here to figure out how to bring this changing climate issue and its ramifications. We're here to talk about your communities and what you'd like your communities to be, since climate change adaptation is a multiple year endeavor. And instantly, he says, right, of course it takes a while to build trust, but instantly people actually like the refreshment that says, we're here because someone will pay for this microphone for climate change. But actually, we're here to talk about the communities that you want and what makes you, you know, insecure. And so that you build conversations that way. And it seems to me that that's one of the models. The second thing is climate change is ubiquitous and very, very threatening on in a lot of levels. And in this sense, it's framing as an environmental issue in people's mind is a problem, right? So I think what we have to bring, what you have to bring to climate change policy design is the notion that when you engage in stakeholder policy design and ongoing conversations and coalition building, that you're not building a coalition to get an environmental bill passed. It's not the same thing, right? It's that you're talking about this sort of changing pattern and how people want to respond to it. In my mind, it's a lot more like conversations about inequality or about the kind of communities that people want to live in the future than it is about whether or not they're responding to climate change by building their houses at the right level so that when the water comes in, they're slightly above it.
Yeah, if John Barnett were here, he'd talk about agency and facilitating that, which really breaks down our walls of what is a climate intervention, right? For small island states, it's about mobility, labor laws, immigration laws, remittances, banking, so that while facing in some ways existential threats to their security because of sea level rise, at the same time they have the ability to make choice and at least try to lower that.
I think that's right, and I would just also add that that thinking about climate change and climate change policy interventions in that framework also does break down the sort of north-south and other kinds of divides that often occupy our minds, right? So one of the things going on in Boston and all around the coast is that people know that they're in neighborhoods that are in danger of water during the storms. They know this, right? They also know that because land has become so valuable, the land right on the coast with the water views, those new developments, they just build to like the new level, right? So you put the parking underneath and everything, and then all those people who just paid $1 million for a condo with a harbor view, they're above water, right? And the buildings right around, nothing happens for the communities right around that, right? And so this is when you bring these kinds of, when you bring participation about people's experience in the communities, they tell you different things about climate policy than, you know, at what level the first floor should be, and that sort of thing.
How about Roger Mark's second portion of questions? Why don't we can give folks a chance to respond to that, and then I'll be our concluding. So who would like to jump off? Josh?
So one thing I would say on the diplomatic side is not to raise expectations that there's going to be a lot of extra money coming from the U.S., which I want to say that because if you come in like, here we are to help, yet we have a dysfunctional Congress that can't appropriate money for Zika, like let alone climate adaptation in other parts of the world. I just think we have to say, how can I help you recognizing that I don't have any money, right? I think we have to be honest about, you know, maybe we can unlock NOAA, NASA assets so that here you have more knowledge than you maybe had before. Or maybe we can facilitate, you know, access to multilateral money, or I can point you to the Chinese who have a little bit more money than we do these days. But I think in all honesty, we can't come up and pretend that there's going to be a huge flow of financial resources their way. There's going to be portents and debates about loss and damage and the like, but I'm not sure if that leads anywhere. So I don't want to raise expectations that are going to be unmet, right? And so, so one thing we have to think about is what can we do? And sit down with our diplomats and say, we have a lot of capabilities and information in the U.S. government that is freely available to U.S.-based researchers and even people in the mass public. But if you have low bandwidth and have a dial-up modem in other parts of the world, you don't have access to. There are ways in which we've already invested in these public goods. Can we help push that out to our embassies and other actors on the ground so that they can get information? But they're going to have to do a lot to try and self-protect, because the reality is, despite historic injustice of, you know, the West being responsible for this problem, we're not in a position politically probably to be much use.
So specific tools that are in the memorandum, well, there is a working interagency working group that's created, but ba-dum-bum. You know, we all, I think, can be kind of cynical about that, and there are some experiences that suggest that, you know, there are real problems with that sort of thing. I think the 90-day and 150-day requirements, the 90-day requirement for plan, 150 days for an implementation plan, is going to force folks to focus on this and do some thinking about that. That's a kind of a short time, and I think that's probably good. I think the, you know, there's a tendency to say, well, if you have no time, you just roll out what you've already got. Well, it'll be pretty good, actually, to roll out what people already got and hold it up to the light and take a look at it. And I think that, you know, the longer you go, the more it kind of becomes a kind of a pedestrian process. So I think that's interesting. I think the U.S. Global Change Research Program is a tool in this context, and it's specifically mentioned to, you know, coordinate with that in the memorandum. I think that's really good. We had a really interesting meeting, I think it was in this room, about 10 days ago on that for the fourth, they're gearing up to do the fourth national climate assessment. It's quite clear that that is going to be more of a risk assessment than the previous ones, which had a more descriptive character. It's also quite clear that partly because of the legislation and partly because of just, I don't know, the way the thinking is going, it's going to have a very sectoral kind of structure to it. So here's food, here's water, here's energy, here's et cetera. Well, these issues are cross-sectoral. And I think to do a good risk assessment, you've got to get outside of those sectoral boxes. You've got to start looking at, here are four or five factors that are converging to create risks. So I think there's a real opportunity there. Both to make that assessment better and also to use that assessment to bring some of these issues to the front. I think without a doubt, the most important tool in the whole thing is the requirement that agencies be climate sensitive, that they account for the climate consequences of their actions, which is not a national security requirement or an economic requirement or a social justice requirement. It's all of the above. It doesn't say why. It simply says that you have to. There's an enormous do-no-harm potential here. And simply by taking what I would call a pair of green scissors to a lot of the things that we do that are climate undermining in all sorts of ways. And so if that climate sensitivity requirement is taken seriously, you know, just inevitably by paying attention to the factor, you'll start to recognize some of the second and third order ways that you're having harmful consequences on it. And so I think pursuing that do no harm approach in the 90-day plans and the 150-day implementation plans would actually be a very positive thing.
When I look at the plan, I think really of how do we bring in the requirement to analyze the causes. And I do think the causes can be analyzed. I don't think they can be weighed so obviously and easily in their causal contribution. But I think many more of those causes can be brought in. And there are two very obvious ways of doing that. One is to try and represent a much broader swath of social and political economic analysis in understanding why the problems we care about are happening. We don't care about a climate event. We care about losses of valued attributes. We care about hunger, famine, dislocation, economic loss. The event isn't the issue. We want to know the causes of those things as best we can specify them so that we can actually analyze what are the possible options for reducing those damages. And it may not be by guarding ourselves from a climate event. It may be through other sorts of things like putting buildings on stilts. Which may be another way of, well, that's guarding. Maybe like having people have more income so that they can go to a hotel for the week and come back or repair after or the like. There are a number of things, but by understanding the politics that marginalize certain people and push them into precarious spaces is very important. And to me, the way that needs to be done is through bringing in the social sciences in the sense of democratizing modeling and democratizing the kinds of advising and the kinds of framings we have for what the problem is. Secondly, by democratizing implementation. And that really is in insisting on working with democratic local authority when we implement programs anywhere in the world. We already do this in places like New York after Sandy. But we need to be doing this in rural Senegal, in Uganda, in Ethiopia, in a way that those people are not just being consulted. They need to have consent, and it needs to not just be one interested group, but a more democratic swath. And I think those two things as requirements in this process would go a long way to improving the way we frame the options.
Okay. I guess we're going in a row. So it's building off of what Jesse has just mentioned. In terms of specific tools, I think that there are some diplomatic approaches that we simply don't have in our toolbox right now that could potentially be useful, especially in terms of building democratic and legitimacy of different approaches to problems. And one of the things that I talk about a lot are these politics of difference and thinking about who can actually, if you can bring diverse voices to a table, who can actually speak at that table. And even if you can get diverse voices, if they are not involved in sort of, and I've said this in other spaces, constructed the table, then you're already at the outset marginalizing those voices from the process. So I guess I think I would emphasize the need for thinking about alternative forums for making decisions, whether they're at the global scale or at the national, regional, subnational, or even the village level scale, that there are alternative ways of talking through issues that can help both foster democracy but also generate legitimacy of these approaches to solving problems. So meeting people where they are, I think, would be really important regardless of who those people are that you're meeting.
So meeting people where you are, nice transition actually to where I wanted to go. I think my colleagues have covered a lot of good, great tools. Actually, one thing I would like to offer is a plea for an approach. I think there's a real risk, especially when we're talking about sort of backdraft issues. You've heard today how complex this gets. And I think there's a presumption that you can't talk about complex things in policy settings. And that's just not true. But it's how you do it. And so the plea is to work more in partnership with folks who spend their time doing this complex thinking, to partner with folks who have those policy and implementation responsibilities to think about how to communicate this information. I'll give you an incredibly short example because I know we're short on time. I had the pleasure of serving as the climate advisor to a presidential appointee, Nancy Lindborg, who ran Democracy, Conflict, and Humanitarian Assistance for a while here at USAID. And while I was in that seat, we had adaptation funding, but we had no mitigation funding at all. So we were worried about adaptation stuff, but like Red Plus was off the table for DACHA to think about. Except that, this is back in 2010, I personally was kind of concerned with the way that some of this forest carbon stuff was being implemented. I was worried about people getting displaced from forests and all kinds of things. And so backdraft effects were like front and center in my mind. And no one else seemed to want to talk about this, but I did know one thing, which is that Nancy wanted our bureau to work on things such that USAID and the US government would have to respond less frequently in the future. In other words, we would do good things so that we would not be set, address some of these underlying issues so we would not have to respond. And so I walked into her office, I had to brief her, and I was talking about this stuff, and she said, why are you talking to me about Red Plus? We don't have mitigation money. And I said, well, you know, the way we're doing this, we're probably gonna displace a bunch of people, and when we do, they're all gonna end up in really bad situations, at which point we'll be responding to that. And there was about a two-beat pause, and she said, we care about Red Plus. And I said, there we go. But you have to have someone who's in the room, and you have to have someone who understands what the motivation is, and you have to understand how to deliver that message. And if you're not that person, you need to find that person, because these complex stories can be conveyed in the right way to folks. Yeah. So that's an approach, if not a tool.
Thank you. Oh, going last, all the best ideas have been taken. everything they said. So one thing I think is a really interesting tool, if we can figure it out, is a genuinely multi-sector risk assessment tool. I'm yet to see one. But it would be great if we could move towards a risk analysis approach that goes beyond layering all the different risks that a particular place, identity group, et cetera, face, and actually understand the interactions between those. And I think that is a direction that we're going in within the risk resilience community, but I think there's still quite a distance to travel. Climate-sensitive development, humanitarian interventions, et cetera, that has been mentioned, but I'd just like to underscore that. That's incredibly important. There's a lot, I mean, there might not be a lot more money to address climate security, but there is money, like $24 billion went into humanitarian aid last year. It's the highest it's ever been, and it's either going to stay there because it's not really, you know, need isn't going down anytime soon. So how do we ensure that that's climate sensitive? We're looking at, you know, huge refugee camps in Lebanon, in Turkey, in Jordan, which are extracting groundwater at such unprecedented rates that, you know, it's so clear that there could be a very simple, cost-effective climate proofing, which would ensure energy and water sustainability, or at least reduce the climate blindness of this. So there's a lot that can be done around that in areas of investment that we're already kind of committed to. But another thing I'd like to add to that is conflict sensitivity. I think that's an incredibly important tool. We've touched on it. It goes beyond do no harm. It means actually understanding the context you're in, understanding the implications of your intervention in the context, understanding the interactions of that context on your intervention, and understanding how you can minimize the negative impacts and maximize the positive towards peace. So making sure that everything that we're doing around adaptation and mitigation is conflict sensitive, I think, is a really critical tool or approach. And then the final kind of just observation is around the label of climate change. I think Stacey and Jesse mentioned that when they've spoken to people, they haven't said that climate change is their number one priority on the ground. And I found the same. In fact, I did an entire research project around vulnerability to climate change where I didn't use the word climate change once in all of our field research across 4 or 5 countries. Our donor was furious because they said we funded a climate change research project, but it was enlightening just to see how people frame their risks. And actually, if they're not identifying climate change as the root cause, well, why should we expect them to? We're not identifying climate change as the root cause of things that, you know, are multiply causal and complex. But the same then applies to solutions. So why then, because something has a climate change label on the funding pot, should we ensure that those solutions are climate change projects? So in how solutions are identified or how the funding is distributed, we shouldn't be locked into the way that the current climate finance mechanisms require things to be different, separate, additional to development interventions. It needs to be stuff that enables integrated approaches, things that allow us to address, you know, strengthening dialogue, trust building, livelihoods, food issues. It doesn't have to look like climate change, because very often it's not going to be about, you know, building a flood wall. It's going to be a lot more complex than that.
Great. We promised a lot of different angles, perspectives on backdraft issues, bottom up, some very much top down with some of the geoengineering examples. And I think it accomplished some of what we wanted to do, which was reconnect with some of the earlier work, call this kind of ongoing work to the attention of a diverse group of people, and really highlight the ability to connect with this work, whether it's through New Security Beat and the ongoing online presence for the center that many of these folks are regularly participating in, and then also to have folks identify themselves as interested and bring their contributions into the discussion as well. So I want to thank our panelists for very thoughtful presentations, for the questions. Roger, Mark, Lauren, and the team here at the Wilson Center for making this possible. And we hope you will continue to stay engaged in these variety of mechanisms, and join me in thanking our guests.
Yeah.
So they work together.
climate, precipitation, until they.